No, he's the Department of the Army IG. General Vollrath is in charge of all personnel for the Army. General Siegfried and General Foote are the two co-leaders of the senior review panel. So you have the people that have the most knowledge about the documents. They're here to answer any of your questions. Fill in any of the details you wish, and I will let them sort of run the panel. And David, you want the first question?
I guess I'm struck most by the statement that Aberdeen was an aberration. It seems to me, if you read this report, the conclusion you draw is that Aberdeen was the inevitable consequence of these problems that you found. Lack of institutional commitment to equal opportunity, a system in which women believe there's absolutely no point in making a complaint about sexual harassment. Why is, except in numbers, why is Aberdeen an aberration?
The fellow that made the comment to the Secretary of the Army was me. I had the opportunity to go literally everywhere where we have got soldiers. We don't have soldiers who are cowering in fear of being sexually molested. It isn't there. We have soldiers that have a great deal of confidence in their drill sergeant. And I think the inspector general will tell you the same thing. They say, not my drill sergeant. My drill sergeant's wonderful. I can give you anecdotal stuff. I said, we were so mad that we all went and called our mamas. And I'm telling you, in sitting with a bunch of soldiers and having them at ease, to just have them tell you stories about that, just tell Steve, hey. In addition to that, you're talking about an effort that in methodology had all kinds of opportunity for anything to arise in an anonymous nature. Not only surveys, but focus groups stratified by rank, so nobody's afraid, stratified by gender, with the facilitators of the same gender. You're talking about interviews of leaders, all of them asked the same question. But more importantly, you're talking about some unguided missiles called Foote and Siegfried and Kennedy and Ellis wandering around in laundromats and in mess halls and in food courts and PXs, just talking to soldiers. And I'm telling you that we didn't find that. Did we find sexual harassment? Yeah, we did, everywhere we went, okay? It took the form of crude and offensive behavior, okay, not sexual misconduct. Talking about inappropriate comments. It's talking about jokes and posters and hitting on people for dates and that sort of stuff. A lot of the women just talk, say, hey, look, we're big boys and girls. We're handling this. And you get them into a small group and say, well, okay, some of it we don't appreciate, but we just sort of put up with it. Well, we made a tough call. We said, hey, we don't have to put up with that. We had another comment about the leadership also that I think you need to understand. If you look at the data, we ask a series of questions about trust and confidence in the leadership. We could have told you this in the report. Twice as many people responded to those questions affirmatively rather than negatively. We didn't do that. On one of the questions, it was 27% of the folks who said, no, we don't have trust and confidence. Okay. It wasn't the 50% that said, yes, it's okay. We said, you know, as an institution, we can do better than that. And in the opinion of the panel, that's too many. So don't read too many as too many to correct or too much to overcome. It's just in the opinion of the panel that we could do better than that. There's another aspect of that. I think probably in the end analysis, one of the biggest things we will have done for the United States Army, based on its courage to let us go do it, is to give it a set of base data from which to compare. I can't tell you that 27% is worse or better than it was 2 years ago because we don't have the data. Now we do. Okay, so we made some tough calls here. We were told to do that. We were given that sort of latitude. And I tell you, when the chief stands up and says that the secretary's got courage, you've got an outfit that made a commitment to its soldiers, not just to go to Aberdeen and fix that, not just to look at the training. So we're going to go everywhere where there are soldiers. We talked to over 7.5% of the entire active force. When they say it's unprecedented, nobody has ever done one that large in terms of methodology and scope. Okay? And then we came back and told that story to the whole world. I had several members of Congress tell me, I said, man, that takes a lot of courage. I said, yes, it does, but we're committed to soldiers. We're excited about that. That's a good news story, and I hope it gets told.
Can I add one more point as sort of a discriminator? That in terms of Aberdeen, much that we saw at Aberdeen fell within the criminal purview. This is criminal behavior. But where we found sexual harassment throughout the Army, the incidents of truly criminal behavior, sexual abuse or absolute rape, were very minor compared to the other forms of sexual harassment that were not so egregious. So Aberdeen as an aberration in that sense is it's a valid point. Sexual harassment in any form is improper behavior. And what we want to highlight now is that we've identified it, the troops have told us, we have the proof, let's go do something about it.
General Foote, we, along the way, trying to do our jobs, we're trying to figure out what you all were doing and what you were coming up with, and we heard various reports about how the report itself was being modified and changed, and we knew about the survey that had been given out in a second form. You and the other panel members, did you modify the final report? Is there anything that you're unhappy about? Is there some point that's not emphasized the way you'd like it to be emphasized?
I don't think so. I said there were even rumors that there was a great deal of contention among the members of the panel. There was one heck of a lot of dialogue, shall we say spirited dialogue. Because with the people on the panel bringing different viewpoints into this very emotional arena, we're going to come from different directions on looking at the same problem. But the group, as a group, worked together for one purpose, and that was to tell the soldier's story and to make the recommendations which, if implemented, will make it a heck of a better Army for them and for the Army itself. There's a lot that has been said about the six questions that were dropped. Let me tell you about that. When we first came together in December, we started from ground zero with he and I wandering through empty offices, setting this up, and knowing full well that any project this enormous required training time and preparation time. So that first 6 weeks was really a train-up organizational time. We did not have time, although we had great scientists working with us, seven behavioral scientists out of Army Research Institute and others throughout the process, who were our validators in terms of the instruments we used, the protocols that were developed, and how we scientifically gathered the data. But in having to start from scratch and build the protocols, we had no time to field test it. So consequently, on that first trip out into the field, at a couple of installations, we had such a negative reaction from some of the troops themselves as to the offensive nature of five or six questions that we had instances where the troops walked out. That particular form of the survey had already been distributed rather widely and was already overseas to be used there. So we couldn't make any modifications or consider any alterations till we got back into the building and had a chance to, do we really need these six questions answered, which are talking about behavior off post and organizations off post that have nothing to do specifically with the environment we're talking about. Although, yes, I would guess you would say if you're talking about sexist behavior, there could be some similarity or some relationship. But gosh, when you've got 162 questions and the only thing you're dropping or thinking about dropping are six that the troops object to, we've still got 156 questions, focus groups, discussion groups, and interviews that will give us all the data we need. So we made the decision at that time.
I was struck in reading your report, especially about how much of the response to your questions really had not that much to do with the issue of sexual harassment, but had to do with the way the Army is run. Mm-hmm. And concerns in your findings, the leadership concerns, you say the troops seem to not be focused at certain points. There were a lot of findings that had nothing to do with it. Can you address that? Were you surprised in your search that you began to get this feedback on issues that really don't have much to do with that?
Not at all, because sexual harassment is just one manifestation of dysfunctional behavior that we were really charged to go out and look at when you're talking about the entire human relations environment. So the questions that were developed were questions that would identify respect and dignity issues, whether or not your sex itself influenced how you were treated in your unit or by your leaders, questions about leadership, and also questions about have you ever been sexually harassed. There were a whole array of questions that address the entire human relations environment.
Gentlemen, we focused ourselves at the beginning.
Yeah.
We said this is not a gender issue. If we got rid of all the men tomorrow, would sexual harassment go away? The answer is no. If we got rid of all the women, would it go away? Certainly not. I mean, that's silly. We said it's not a women in combat issue. If we opened up all the MOSs in the Army tomorrow for women, would sexual harassment go away? Well, that's ridiculous. Now, that's an issue that the Army has to deal with, and the Congress has, and the press and the American people. But we said, no, the panel's charter is not that. It's something else. In addition, we said, hold, it's probably not a sexual harassment issue. That's a symptom, like Pat says, of a bigger problem, and that's the way we treat each other as professionals. Whether we wear a beret, whether we jump out of an airplane, work a typewriter, pump gas, or charge a hill, every professional has the absolute right to demand to be treated with respect and dignity. And our charter was purposely left that broad. We literally looked at the human relations environment in the entire Army a way that it has never been done by anybody.
That's really what you seem to find wanting, though, is that respect and dignity, which General Reimer kept coming back to as the thing that he's going to be stressing. You found a hollowness in this Army about the way people treat each other.
I wouldn't say that at all, John, because you got to read the first paragraph, because we wrote it on purpose and because it's the truth. What we saw was the world's finest Army, trained and ready and proud to be called soldiers. What we found were drill sergeants who are out there making that magic happen, overworked and underpaid. But we really delved into the, and what I think what we're talking about here is dusting off a diamond, not chumping away at a lump of coal, okay? That point is made in the first paragraph, I think, of both reports. And we're going to do the dusting.
Yes.
General, you look pretty closely at Aberdeen.
Yes, sir.
Give us... one, two, three things align to contribute to the drill sergeant situation there, or
let me talk about a little bit about methodology. We did look closely at Aberdeen, but our charter, as you know, was the training base at large. Every place we train soldiers, and we went to every place, including the Air Force places and the Navy places where we train Army soldiers. And in that context, we looked at the EOC, Equal Opportunity System, we looked at the drill sergeant business. Let's start with the drill sergeant business. You or someone else earlier talked about this issue about selection. And what we found was there's some things that we should be doing when we select drill sergeants to preclude people who shouldn't be in that business from getting through. Quite frankly, there are people who have been punished under our system who are in jail who would not have been selected to be drill sergeants if we had looked into what we call looked into their restricted fish or the restricted personnel file, because there were incidents there that should have told us, no, let's not select this person to be a drill sergeant. We can obviously tighten that up. We also found that this 70% of our drill sergeants who are selected by the Army as opposed to volunteer don't get some of the checks. They had not up to that point been, their commanders had not been asked, their senior commander, do you think this man or woman is suited for this duty? We need to do a better job at that. We need to do a better job at psychological testing to see if they're right for this duty. Now, having said that, and go back to the chief or the secretary's response to you, still the overwhelming numbers of drill sergeants doing their job are doing it in a magnificent fashion, and all their trainees vote on their behalf. So what we're saying is there are some things we could do which probably would have precluded some of the people getting into the system who caused us some problems and make sense for us to do downrange. So that's the drill sergeant piece, and it extends beyond just Aberdeen. There are a series of things factors at Aberdeen that are factors some other places in the Army that we think the Army's got to look at. And one of them is, for example, that commanders down through about the lieutenant colonel level have had most of the time a sort of split focus between responsible for training soldiers and also being responsible for other things. For example, classroom instruction, where you have a battalion-level commander who has both those responsibilities. When you think about the small size of his staff, when you think about what the chief said about the number of officers and NCOs in the company, if you give that first sort of senior commander responsible for ability for more than focusing on soldier training, you create an environment where perhaps he or she won't spend as much time focused as he should. So that multiple focus was an issue at Aberdeen. It's an issue other places where we train soldiers, and we think TRADOC's got to take a look at that. We were concerned at Aberdeen with what we refer to as leader presence. The presence on the ground of leaders, especially mid to senior level leaders, both officer and NCOs. We were concerned about the amount of time that the command sergeant's majors were spending on the ground with their soldiers as opposed to involved in administrative duties. We were concerned about that in other places in TRADOC. That's why you see it in the report as a finding. We were concerned about this other business of the reductions in the Army and what it did. It's the second and third order effect that's occurred to us. If you take away the civilians that drive buses and the other cadre that supervise the sort of administration of the organization, who takes up the slack? The drill sergeant takes it up. The drill sergeant ends up driving the bus or taking the private to get his or her medical appointment done, and it takes them away from their primary duty. Those second and third order effects of the Army's reduction in size had an impact at Aberdeen and elsewhere in TRADOC.
Does fixing the problems that have been identified, does this amount to just a series of administrative changes? Is it going to continue to be resource constrained? In other words, will it be difficult to achieve? Or is it more of a cultural shift that's going to take a long time and could be a struggle over time?
Let me start and then let Fred, who's got the action plan, talk a little bit about the action plan itself. I mean, I think it's all of that, Rick. I think it's it starts with the Army, General Hartsog, the new deputy for training, sitting down and looking at the model that they're using and asking themselves the question, does this model still work everywhere we're trying to make it work? What are the things, in addition to what we've already started doing in terms of putting structure back into it, that we need to do beyond that? It is always going to have the tension of resource constraint. I mean, we are in a resource constrained environment, and every lieutenant, for example, that we put in TRADOC to be an executive officer is a lieutenant that's not somewhere else. Every drill sergeant that we add is an NCO who's not somewhere else in the Army. And you all know that as well as I because of your jobs. That kind of tension is going to remain. I'm not prepared to say cultural shift. I'm prepared more to say, you know, starting with the chief's quote from 1879, there's just some reminders here about leadership, and there's some reminders here. The kind of thing that I've been preaching as the IG, and hopefully before that as an Army leader, that the busier an outfit is, the more it's got to talk to itself. And the problem is when you're busy, you have less and less time to talk to yourself. You have less and less time for leaders to spend time talking to soldiers at every level so that you get at this issue of teamwork and dealing with each other, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't think it's a cultural shift. I think it's a reinforcement of what sort of tried and true principles of leadership that are going to be important but tough to do in a resource-constrained environment.
The plan really gets back, in my terms, to basics. I would not term it an attempt for a cultural shift so much as going back to the basics. If you take a look at it, there are over 300 specific actions in the action plan. What I say about that is that there are no silver bullets. There are no one or two actions that are going to make it better and make it better overnight. It's a plan that has to be executed in its totality. And over time, and that's the reason the Secretary and the Chief talked about follow-on actions, because we could do all of this, and 1 year from now, if we didn't take a look at ourselves again, we wouldn't know if we were any better or any worse. So you've got to follow through on this plan. Let me go back to the resource. Clearly, we've got many things that we have to balance, but the Army understands that we have got to pay for what we want. Secretary talked about increasing the number of equal opportunity advisors. That's an increase from 340 authorized positions to 500. The chief talked about, and the secretary did, adding 1 week to basic training. That's a significant resource cost to the United States Army, because throughout a span of a year, that represents 1,400 man years, which translates to a force structure issue. If you take a look in the report, we talk about drill sergeants and how to improve the way we select drill sergeants, but also how we take care of drill sergeants and the status that we give them. In the action plan, we talk about looking at increasing the pay that we give them for that particular duty. They already receive special duty assignment pay. We give that pay to them gradually increased as they work their way over time into that job. We're looking at giving them the full pay the day they start on the trail. That means immediately paying them an extra $275 a month. That is $1 million decision. $1 million decision to go and do that. So, yes, there are resource implications in this action plan, and yes, the Army is going to take it on, but we will have to balance it over.
Can I follow up on that? The shorthand of that question is, my question is kind of a tag on, are the reformers going to put their money where their mouth is? I've never been to a training command yet where they say, look, they keep hitting us, we don't have enough trainers. If we ever had to go to war, we'd be in terrible trouble. We couldn't expand this base to handle the people to fight any kind of war. Every time they downsize us, they take the resources out of the training command.
Right.
Okay, you tell me where the money's going to come from and how much it is.
Let me go back to the question. Can you give me a better definition of the question?
Yeah, how much money are you going to put in this reform effort, and where is it going to come from?
Well, in part, I've told you 1,400 spaces, $1 million for that pay. Clearly, I haven't ticked off what the cost is of the additional up to 500 spaces. That money is going to come internally from other Army programs, period.
OAM, procurement, where?
In MPA, military personnel appropriation, trade-off, and O&M, clearly. There's no doubt about it.
So the budget and we are signed off, are they signed off on this?
For the decisions, yes. Represented in the action plan, yes. Signed off. We do not intend to go back over to Congress and ask for more money in this regard. We will, within Army, work the appropriate trade-offs.
So how many bucks are we talking about total?
In total, I have not added that up, but I'll certainly try to do that for you. I have not costed out additional spaces.
Less than $1 billion?
Oh, certainly less than $1 billion.
General Siegfried, you said that this is a question of dusting off a diamond.
Yes, sir.
But when you looked at this from your previous experience in the Army, were you surprised or disappointed or pleased with what you found in terms of the way leaders treat their soldiers? Did you think soldiers were being treated with more respect than you actually found out once you got into it? What was your reaction to what you found?
I'll tell you, great question. The first thing that struck me is how busy the Army is. And the chief talked about that, but it's more than downsizing 600,000 and closing 700 bases. I know that you all recognize that sometime in May we were in 100 different countries at one time. For example, I visited every Patriot battery in Southwest Asia. I said, wow, it just struck me how inordinately busy this Army is relative to what it was 10 years ago before we started the downsizing, okay? The effects of that are that soldiers don't see their chain of command, okay? Let me give you a little anecdotal thing. I walked in on a company commander about 5:30 one morning. I was going to take PT with him. He didn't know that. And the guy's sitting at his computer. It's on a Monday morning. He's getting tasks on email from his battalion commander. I said, where's this guy at? He said, he's 100 yards down the road on the other side of the street. I said, okay, let me go find this guy. Because there's this company commander's reading his email taskers, and he ain't going to take PT. So I go find a battalion commander. This guy's getting ready to go off on an extended deployment for 30 days because he's got to fill up somebody else. Okay, so Now he's relegated to getting ready to rush out, so, oh, my God, I got these things going on. That sort of permeates where we're at. I talked to a young soldier and said, why'd you use a local hotline? He had called a local hotline. I said, hey, tell me about that. He said, sir, my platoon sergeant is off at ANOC. My company commander is, he was at jump master school, and his battalion commander is off at a warfighting experiment someplace. He said, I need some help. So has he got trust and confidence in his chain of command? And if you ask him, he'd say no. By the way, soldiers have got a God-given right to bitch. Okay, I mean, that's as plain as I can put it. And this process went out and asked them, tell us what the gripes are, okay? And I'm not trying to negate anything that we put in report, because we told their story and we told it in uncompromising fashion. When you add all this busyness up, soldiers watch your feet, not your lips. You can talk about respect and dignity until you're blue in the face, but they watch what you do. And if you ain't there, if you're not with them, like General Bates says, they get the idea you don't care. We've got an awful busy Army. I think that's the biggest problem, and that's the biggest thing that struck me. And that's why we hit so hard on the leadership aspect of the respect and dignity, because it is directly related to combat effectiveness. It's a warfighting issue, the unit cohesion that comes from leaders being there and available for their soldiers at all times. I hope I answered your question.
Can I follow up on that? There's a, yeah. Kind of a paradoxical paragraph in here under the leadership a part that says, it talks about this high op tempo, high purse tempo. You deploy units, basically, and based, I think, some, to summarize, it almost says that morale is better in these, and command climate seems to be better in these units. Am I getting that right? Or?
Not what we said. One of the best environments we found, and by the way, we promised anonymity to all the folks we went to. I mean, it was transparent. Nobody's going to be able to come back to you and say where this came from. Very struck by the best environment we found was in a forward deployed unit. Got to tell you, got a world-class, miserable op tempo, tough mission, away from home, bad living conditions, but the leadership there had just absolutely committed itself to not letting that hold them back. We also found forward deployed units where that wasn't true. Okay, so it's not the going on a mission that makes it better.
You can't generalize.
No, you cannot. We were trying to make the point is that if we work hard at it, you don't have to let this op tempo and all this other stuff take away from your commitment to the soldiers, the human relations environment that you got. Other forward deployed units, we found forward deployed units where, in order to take care of sexual harassment, they just didn't want to talk to the women. Okay, that just drives a wedge between soldiers and stuff. Okay, so it's not being forward deployed.
Yeah. I'd add just one thing, Rick, to what Steve said, and that you can generalize to a degree that soldiers in general sign up to do the things that are in their MOS. And so in many cases, that includes deploy. That includes go to strange places and try to avoid being killed by people that you don't know. And that is, in fact, a part of the adventure that they sign up for. And there is a positive piece of that. That is not to take away from what General Siegfried said, which is when you go to those places, you find internal to those organizations some units that are doing all of these leadership issues a hell of a lot better than others. If that makes any sense.
General Bates, I'd like to ask you a little bit, if you could discuss a little bit the investigation your officers conducted into the chain of command.
Yeah.
What specifically were the faults that they found that the officers who are receiving letters of command, to include the general officer, committed? And secondly, was there any disagreement between the TRADOC senior levels of command and officials at the Department of the Army over that? Because as you're probably aware, the hot rumor several months ago was that no general officer was going to be disciplined for this. And you know, that rumor was out and then it got retracted specifically by the Secretary. And I'm just wondering whether the Secretary or anyone else at DA leaned on this process?
Let me talk about the process to begin with. One of our objectives was accountability and responsibility chain of command across the training base. We put a separate team together, headed by two very senior colonels, one of whom was a former chief of investigations in my organization. I do all of the senior officer investigations in the Army. So that individual who we brought back for this and another very senior colonel ran this team. And it looked at chain of command accountability at Aberdeen. It selected two other posts because they're large training bases for comparative purposes and purpose of context. And they were Fort Jackson and Fort Leonard Wood. And then in addition to that, they and the other members of my assessment team looked at this issue of accountability and responsibility at every one of the installations that we went to. The generic findings from that look are in the report, and you can obviously pick through them at your leisure and figure out the specifics. The issues, and I should add to that, that when we did this, we sat down and asked ourselves, okay, what constitutes accountability and responsibility? We came up with basically four broad categories: policy, resourcing, execution, and supervision as the four general categories. And then who's in this chain? And we said, okay, the chain starts at Department of the Army, Secretary of the Army, Chief of Staff, Army Staff, and goes, in this case, through TRADOC and down into each installation. And so we looked at chain of command accountability and responsibility in those four categories at every one of those levels. And we considered the names involved at each level. Now, in every case, we provided the data that we had as it had to do with individuals to the appropriate authority. In the case of general officers, that was to General Griffith. And we did that through a series of briefings and repetitive discussions about what we found and how it compared to other installations. In the case of colonels and below, we provided that data in a series of discussions to the CG TRADOC. I'm not going to go into the specifics of what we criticized individuals, because it's inappropriate for me to do that as the IG. We never do that. In fact, we are always absolutely uncomfortable in getting into this business outside of the people that we work for. In my case, I report to the secretary as his representative and to the chief as his advisor. But we were very specific about the individuals involved, and the issues turn as you get more senior up the chain of command, as someone brought up earlier today, and I don't remember who asked, what about General Hartzog? Rick, I don't know whether it was you or someone else. Yeah, said, well, what about? The answer is we looked at
the rationale behind where you stopped.
Surely. And the answer is we didn't stop. We looked at what we thought his responsibilities were and how well he carried them out, and we found fault as appropriate. And we turned that over to the vice chief, to the chief, and the secretary for their judgments. Obviously, the issue here is criminality on the ground in training companies at Aberdeen Proving Grounds or somewhere else, and how does that accountability and responsibility chain flow, and to what the degree of responsibility does each individual...
So does that mean accountability implies criminal behavior or complicity in criminal behavior, as opposed to simply poor leadership?
No, it doesn't mean that. It means that if you have criminal behavior and you've got leaders in charge of those organizations, what did they know or did they not know, and why was that the case? Had they done as much as they could before the fact, during and after the fact, those kinds of issues? It's not tied to the issue of criminality.
Mark. General Siegfried and General Foote, I'm sure you'd give your effort an A+, but looking at the whole human relations environment in the Army, would you each give it a grade? And also, when I read the report, I saw it as rather a scathing indictment of the way the Army handles human relations problems, yet you just talk about a dusty diamond. I don't understand the disconnect. Where's the disconnect?
Well, there's nothing in there that is meant to be scathing about anything. And we opened the thing up by telling you that what we saw was the Army's best Army. And when you start talking about human relations environment, that's tough business to get your arms around, okay? We also committed ourselves to that we're going to listen to the soldier story, not ours. This is not an easy business that we're in. This is a dirty business, okay? It is, in sometimes, obscene and despicable. And we went to lots and lots of places and got lots and lots of data and recorded it all. In most instances, what you're talking about is a refocus in the way we look at things. The most important part of the human relations environment is that we were not focusing on it as it relates directly to the warfight, to combat readiness, to unit cohesion. It was one of those things that's over here. That's an EO thing. That's sort of touchy-feely kind of mess, and I don't want to deal with that. So what the panel says, wow, what a chance we got here to sort of change some focus in the way we look at human relations issues. It ought to be directly related to the war fight, has been said by the quote from 1829. So our efforts in writing what we wrote was to get the Army to refocus its efforts in that area as it directly relates to the war fight. Okay? I'm sorry?
Give the human relations grade in the Army. What is it?
B.
B to B minus. Because when we went out worldwide, 59 installations, talked to over 30,000 soldiers, overseas and here, and we found everywhere we went on the same installation, we might find absolutely dazzling pockets of excellence because of leadership and pockets of despair for the same reason. So you would find an uneven sorting out of the quality of leadership at a given place. Why? For any number of reasons. I think for some reason, and this is just me talking, that we got away from basics of leadership. We don't have a lot of commanders anymore who've even been schooled in footlocker counseling, in going into the units. We've gotten away from doing soldier-leader types of actions that we used to do. And there are any number of rationales that people use for not having done it, but the truth of the matter is, if you're the commander, you're responsible, and you've got to get down there and get to know your soldiers. So I would say I would give it a B minus. And there are so many problems out there that can be handled by common sense. Common sense and good basic leadership. There's an absolute beautiful correlation between strong, positive leadership and low incidence of inappropriate behavior in units. There's an equally high correlation between poor leadership and a high level of dysfunctional behavior. So it comes back again.
We can prove that
and we've got it. We've got it in the database.
Okay, now that's in volume 2 of the report, if you read that very carefully.
How do you measure good or poor leadership empirically?
Well, when you ask the question, I'm going to get into this scientific stuff, and I'm an infantryman. Okay, Rick, I got to talk in words of one syllable. What we did, we were very careful about the questions we got. We would isolate a variable that talked to the soldiers about how do you feel about the leadership in your company. If that was a good rating, I like the leadership in this company. We then looked at all the other variables as how that one affected it. And then we go to the next one and the next one and the next one. In every instance where there is a positive answer to the good leadership type questions, everything that you'd like to go away goes away, inappropriate behavior, and everything that you'd like to be good gets better. So not only instinctively, as an old soldier, Steve would tell you, leadership is the fundamental here. Now empirically, and I know you're not an empiricist, okay, we got scientific data that can show you that leadership is the answer here, which is why we spend so much time talking about basic leadership in the report.
You know, another aspect of that, though, is this. We have been so very successful at changing behavior in the Army in a number of key areas. Drug and alcohol abuse in one case, aviation safety in another, basic maintenance. Because with those programs, senior leaders and the Army leadership at large added value to the proper exercise of those programs and actually put out the penalties for not executing properly. In other words, if you're caught driving a car and you're under the influence of alcohol, goodbye career. If you're into the drug scene after every rehabilitative effort, you're out of there. And this is what we really need to do in terms of eliminating or having as a goal the elimination of gender discrimination and sexual harassment is set the standard out there for what the behavior has to be, and if you don't comply, then there are actions that can be taken that are going to have a strong impact on careers.
We've
get
done
the
that
attention.
Over and over again. We've done it better than anybody.
It's the whole value-added approach.
Let me give you an example.
Yeah.
Ranger Bates and Siegfried and all of us grew up in an Army where if you didn't go to happy hour on Friday night and have some beer with the folks, you weren't a member of the team. I got to tell you, Siegfried drove home drunk some of those Friday nights. Okay? I did. All of a sudden, the United States Army said, we're not going to do that anymore. They mandated my behavior. I was mad. I said, what are these guys doing? I mean, this is wrong. But I understood that my behavior was now a condition of employment. Mm-hmm. I get one DUI on the way home, I'm out of here. So I griped and complained, but I went to Happy Hour and I only had one drink. And then I went home. Over time, when you mandate behavior, and we do that very well, your attitude changes. Over time, I said, wow, my Friday nights are a lot more productive, and I moved my tea time on Saturday from 11 o'clock till 7 o'clock. Hello. Even now, do you wear a seatbelt? Well, we didn't used to, but everybody does now. We mandate the condition of driving the car. Yeah. When you start talking about respect and dignity towards each other, you're talking about behavior. Mm-hmm. And we as an institution can mandate behavior as a condition of employment. That's doable if we focus it on the war fighting aspect of it. Okay, and get the attention of the Army, as this is a war fighting issue, a leadership issue. And that doesn't cost you anything.
Like, this is not a woman's issue. Sexual harassment is not a woman's issue. It's a readiness issue, it's a leadership issue, and leaders are going to be held responsible and accountable.
General Vollrath, I don't know how to break this to you, Steve, but I had my wife drive me home.
Oh,
one more question, please. The extension of basic training by a week, can you provide a few details about how that's going to work? When are you going to start that? How much is it going to cost? And where are the resources that going to come from? And fourthly, you've been facing a pretty tough recruiting climate over the last year or so anyway. This clearly is going to deprive units in the field of soldiers, all those soldiers, for yet another week. What is the impact going to be on those units in the field?
Mm-hmm. First of all, this change should have no impact on recruiting. The numbers we need to recruit remain the same. Second, you're quite right, there is a cost of doing business by adding the 1 week. I talked briefly about that before. But most of the cost is already sunk cost. The facilities are already there, the drill sergeants are already there, the equipment to train on is already there. So most of that is in place. So the fundamental problem here is what the time, okay, is going to cost. And having looked at that, that's a serious decision, as I indicated before, because that extra time has its most direct cost to the Army in terms of force structure. That's an additional 1,400 soldiers, so to speak, that will not be out in the TONE Army. They will be in that training base. That's the cost. It's that 1 week added up throughout all of the trainees' lives equals about 1,400 spaces. And that the Army is going to have to rebalance in terms of force structure. If you took the 1,400 and you said that the average battalion was 500 persons strong, that means we'd have to try to go and find three battalions someplace in the force structure. We're not going to do that at a battalion level. We'll find them probably in the headquarters elements, et cetera, and it's part of the QDR process. It's been melded into that. So at this stage, I can't tell you it's this unit that comes out of the force and this headquarters that loses X number of people because we put it in that process. But that is a cost, and it will show up in the foxhole eventually.
When is it going to start?
Excuse me, I didn't get that. We would hope to start that at about the first of the year and tack it on, but we've asked Commanding General of TRADOC, General Hartsog, okay, to advise us on that and to implement it as soon as possible.
General Bates, we didn't give you a chance to say whether your own report considered, in your view, Aberdeen an aberration, whether we misread it or whether we read it correctly.
Aberdeen is an aberration in terms of the magnitude of the number of incidents. It's an aberration in the context that in a particular company you had the company commander as well as drill sergeants involved, and therefore in that regard it's an aberration. Are there incidences of should we continue to be concerned about instances of trainee abuse across track? Absolutely, as we have been before and as we will continue in the future. Were we paying as much attention as we should? I mean, that's the issue of accountability, responsibility. Were we paying as much attention as we should at Aberdeen and other places? I think the answer is clear that we probably weren't paying as much attention as we should.
Thank you very much. Now, for future reference, this panel has been empowered further
empowerment. I want to go home.
Provide on the record comments. If you need more, please contact me. We'll make the arrangements with them. Let's hang with that.
Can we make one more comment, though, about the training costs? The end product, though, is a better trained, better disciplined, better motivated soldier who more
understands.
The question
is, what's the cost not to do it? That's the real.
There you go.
Yeah, that field unit that waits that extra weeks can get a better trained soldier.
Thank you.
You bet.
You're entitled to one drink.
He's the program manager for the Joint Program Office of the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization. He is going to provide you an update today on the Integrated Flight Test 1A, which was a very successful flight test conducted on 25 June of this year. And he will also address other national missile defense topics. He'll start off with a briefing, which will consist of a review of the IFT-1A mission, a presentation of the data received from that test, and then an overview update on the next IFT sensor mission scheduled for January 1998. And he'll also be able to answer your questions on the entire scope of the National Missile Defense Program. So, General Consumano.
Thank you, Colonel Bridges. Can you hear me out there? Okay. Well, this morning, before I get into the specifics of the Integrated Flight Test 1A, I'd like to take an opportunity to provide just a brief overview on the National Missile Defense Program, to kind of bring everybody up to date, if you will, and talk in some detail about the complete test program and how the Integrated Flight Test 1A fits into that test program. But first of all, let me just talk about the National Missile Defense Program and what it's all about. So could I have the first slide, please? If you would, hold your questions till I finish a little overview, and then I'll be glad to entertain any questions that you might have on the Integrated Flight Test or the program in general. The mission that I have is shown on this chart, and all this is in your press packages, so I don't think you have to worry about seeing the charts that clearly. Some of them may be small, but this is the mission: develop, demonstrate, and deploy a land-based system, an initial land-based system, to defend against limited strategic missile attacks and capable of evolving to counter future threats. Now, what do we mean about limited strategic missile attacks? We're talking about being able to defend against a rogue state or an accidental or unauthorized launch from a declared nuclear power. Now, to perform that mission, we have a very aggressive program called a 3+3 program. In the first 3 years, I have to be able to develop the system and test the system. And if a deployment decision is made in the year 2000, then 3 years later, I have to deploy a capable system to perform that mission. To manage that effort, we have a joint program office. It's a very unusual office in that it is a joint program office in which we do not have a service lead. Every other major defense acquisition program, to include the Joint Strike Fighter, which is a common one today, all have service leads, but this one does not, because we really didn't want to box ourselves into any particular distinct service solution. We wanted to be able to put together an optimized solution for the joint missile defense problem. And to help me with this effort, we're bringing on board what's called a lead system integrator, an LSI contractor. He's a prime contractor, if you will, to integrate all these efforts of development activities that have been going on for a number of years. Could I have the next slide? A little bit about the test program. And this is an attempt to show you in a holistic sense that there's a lot of activities that are going on that lead to just the integrated flight test that we're talking about today. Here's Integrated Flight Test 1A that was just executed at the end of June that we talked about. There are several other integrated flight tests leading up to an integrated system test in 1999. And then finally, a decision will be made, as I said earlier, after a deployment readiness review in the year 2000 as to whether we'll deploy the system or not. You can see that the way we've laid out our test plan is that if a deployment decision is made, there'll be a number of additional test activities that we'll conduct so that we can ensure ourselves that we have the development necessary and the operational characteristics required for that deployed system if it's deployed. So if you can see by looking at the legend down here, if a deployment decision is made, we're going to add a number of integrated system tests after the year 2000. Now, supporting those integrated flight tests are after the year 1999, an integrated system test, we have integrated ground tests. And these ground test activities primarily take place at Huntsville, Alabama, in an integrated system test capability called the ISTIC at Huntsville, Alabama. And I'll talk more about that on the subsequent slide. We're also taking advantage of what we call risk reduction flight tests. And these are flight tests that are normally operational tests conducted by the Air Force. And these are Minuteman III flights out of Vandenberg Air Force Base in vicinity of Kwajalein. And we're using these flight tests to check our sensors and our battle management command and control. So as you can see, there's a number of activities that lead up to the overall integrated flight test or integrated system test before it's performed. And these activities are attempt to reduce the risk involved in those very expensive tests. Okay, next slide, please. What we normally see, of course, the public sees are the integrated flight tests or the integrated system tests where we actually attempt an intercept or a sensor flyby. But as I mentioned in the last chart, there's a lot of other activities that support that final integrated system test or integrated flight test in which we actually fly a missile. And those activities are shown here. And they begin with a lot of models at the basic environment level where we look at phenomenology and continue up through a number of simulations. And of course, these simulations feed into the ground test environment that I just talked about in Huntsville, Alabama, and then finally to the flight test. And all these things over time add up to greater confidence that we're building a system that will be operationally capable and will meet the mission requirements that I discussed in the first slide. Very important. A lot of the dollars in this program are spent on these activities that lead up to this very visible activity. Of course, this is important, really important. So we do want to spend a lot of time leading up to the activity. Okay. Coming back to the flight test program that leads up to the deployment readiness review in the year 2000, we have two competitors right now who are competing for the exo-atmospheric kill vehicle. And the exo-atmospheric kill vehicle, of course, is a kill mechanism that sits on top of the interceptor and actually separates in outer space. These two competitors are Boeing and Hughes. And the one that I'll talk about today, of course, is the Boeing sensor flight. There are two sensor flights that will take place, the Boeing sensor flight that was just completed and the Hughes sensor flight in January the 18th, I believe. And that will be followed by two intercept flights, one by each competitor. And then finally, the current plan is we'll down select in the year 1999 and carry one contractor for the remainder of the program effort for the overall integrated system test in 1999 and for all other test activities for the program. Next slide. Now let's look at the sensor test, the integrated flight test 1A, in some detail. This is a graphic that shows you the objectives of the integrated flight test. Again, this was just a sensor test. The intent was not to conduct an intercept, but the intent was to demonstrate all these capabilities. Essentially, demonstrate the capability of the sensor to pick up the target objects that were in the target suite and discriminate those target objects, one from another, and from the actual RV that was in the target suite. And I'll show you that in just a moment. But again, it was just a sensor flyby. There was no attempt for an intercept. A little bit about the test. We had the targets flown out of Vandenberg Air Force Base, and they were launched at about 11:40 Pacific time. And then about 20 minutes later, out in the Kwajalein Atoll, Mech Island, specifically, the interceptor was launched with the sensor on top of the interceptor so that it would fly by in close proximity to the target suite in an attempt to see those targets and distinguish the decoys from the actual reentry vehicle that was a part of that target suite. There were nine objects that were launched, and these are the nine objects. As you see here, a large balloon, canisterized small balloon, small canister light replicas, an actual medium reentry vehicle that we were trying to pick out of those decoys and replicas. The bus from the target vehicle that brought the target objects up. Two medium rigid light replicas and some medium balloons that were closely spaced objects close together. And we wanted to see if we could discriminate between those closely spaced objects. Overall, the sensor performed exactly as required. The sensor, we reduced all the data. And as I reported out shortly after the test, we didn't have all the data at the time. But what we did know is that we did have a good deployment of the target objects. We did have a good flyby of the sensor, and everything looked nominal. And I can report to you today that it was a complete success in the ability to pick out each one of these decoys and replicas and discriminate the actual reentry vehicle from the decoys and replica. And that's important for this system because this is a hit-to-kill system, so that later on when we do the intercept test, 3 and 4 for these two competing contractors, we're going after that reentry vehicle. And so that sensor must be sensitive enough, it must have the discrimination capability to do that. And so we proved in this particular sensor flyby that this sensor was able to discriminate and pick out the objects from one another. So in that regard, it was a success. The only anomaly we had was that when the medium balloons were deployed, they were not closely spaced enough to meet what we would call the criteria for closely spaced. Okay. Now, of course, we're doing this sensor test, the integrated flight test 1A, as a risk reduction for the actual intercept test that Boeing will attempt later on in 1998 with an actual kill vehicle. So there are a number of items, and I apologize for the quality of this photo, but you have a better photo in your package. This was taken off your computer. But most of the items that are necessary on the actual kill vehicle that will fly later on in 1998 were flown as a part of the sensor package in late June. So we have some confidence that these items that will be integrated into the actual keel vehicle have been demonstrated, at least for the Boeing competitor, have been demonstrated. So in summary, from our point of view, we believe it was a success. The Seeker performed outstandingly as programmed. All the other items that we wanted to look at in regards to the Seeker were nominal. There were a number of other activities that we were interested in because it had been a number of years since we used Mech Island as a test facility for national missile defense. Matter of fact, in about the mid-1980s was the last opportunity that we had a chance to use that facility. So we were looking at basic things like test infrastructure and those kinds of activities to see if we could actually bring this this infrastructure up and support the National Missile Defense Program. And of course it did, so we're very happy about that also. Now turning to the next integrated flight test, again, which is a sensor flyby. As I mentioned earlier, the second competitor is Hughes. There are some differences in their sensor and the Boeing sensor. Fundamentally, the actual Seeker itself, the substrate characteristics of the Seeker are different. The Boeing Seeker was a silicon Seeker, silicon-based Seeker, and this one is a mercury-cadmium telluride Seeker. So there are some fundamental differences in the Seekers. This will take place. The same flight concept will be used with the targets coming out of Vandenberg Air Force Base, the interceptor out of MEC, and it will be scheduled on January the 16th rather than January the 18th, as I mentioned earlier. And so far, everything for this mission is a go. Everything is green for this mission. The actual interceptor vehicle, as well as the sensors, will arrive on MEC Island starting in November, and they'll begin the integrated process for those particular flight vehicles and sensor. I'd like to turn also to another success story of the NMD program. And my intent, of course, over the next just few minutes is to show you that there's real hardware out there for the National Missile Defense Program and that this activity just didn't start in the last 3 or 4 months or 5 months since I stood up a joint program office. This activity has been going on for a number of years. I had the pleasure of going out to Kwajalein Atoll recently and dedicating the ground-based radar prototype. It is a prototype site radar that would be used, could be used with the National Missile Defense System. And it is an X-band phased array radar. Its primary purpose, of course, is surveillance to assist in discrimination. So we really have a couple of ways to, we have many ways to assist in discrimination. We have upgraded early warning radars. These are UHF radars. We have the GBR that helps in discrimination. And of course, we have the GBI itself, or the EKV, that helps in discrimination, because discrimination really is the toughest part of this mission, is being able to pick out the real target from the replicas or the decoys. So the ground-based radar performs mid-course surveillance, discrimination, and then lastly, kill assessment. Could I have the next slide? This is a picture of the ground-based radar prototype out at Mech Island, out in the Kwajalein Atoll. It is, I am told, the free world's largest X-band phased array radar. It has 123-meter squared aperture, and you can see the number of TR modules. What we've done with this particular radar is we've leveraged off of the THAAD demonstration validation radar, and many of the modules that we have, most of the modules that we have in this particular radar were taken from the old THAAD DIMVAL radar in an attempt to save money, obviously, and the software that supports those transmit-receive modules also came with the package. So we have saved tens of millions of dollars by leveraging off the THAAD program. These are some other characteristics of that ground-based radar prototype. And this is the mechanical part of the radar. The actual elements fit in the front of the array here, and it's not populated yet. This is just the yoke that supports the radar, and the radar is up here, and the electronics and the other portions that support the actual radiation part of the radar will be populated in the November-December time frame, and then we'll start system checkout for this radar, and it will be up and available for the integrated flight test number 4 to shadow that and participate in the integrated system test number 5 in 1999. So in summary, there's been a lot of activity in the National Missile Defense Program in the last 4 to 5 months. Most importantly, obviously, we've got off to a good start, I believe, with standing up the Joint Program Office. We've completed the Defense Acquisition Board process. I've gone through the approval process of approving the program, the program baseline, and dollars to support the program. That's very important for me as a program manager. We're doing a lot of activity in our battle management command and control. And one thing I didn't mention, as a part of Integrated Flight Test 1A, essentially we used our first increment of battle management command and control. We're doing a lot of site planning and visiting, looking at Grand Forks and other places that we might deploy the National Missile Defense System. You may or may not know that in the first 3 years of the 3+3 program, all my activities must be treaty compliant. But the deployment of the system may or may not be treaty compliant, depending upon how we see the threat. And so that decision is not made yet. So as a program manager, I have to be very flexible in my approach to this program and keep a number of architectures, if you will, on the shelf to meet any possible threat that comes up. We've gone through a lot of activities to look at our system requirements documents and reduce those down to technical requirements. In other words, what really needs to be built to meet those operational requirements. I talked to you about the construction of the ground-based radar at Kwajalein. And lastly, the lead system integrator process is going very well. We put on the street about 3 weeks ago the request for proposal for the execution phase for the lead system integrator. And those proposals are due now in November, and we intend to down select to one contractor as a lead system integrator in the March time frame of 1998. There are two contractors competing: United Missile Defense Corporation, which is a joint venture, essentially, and it's competing against Boeing of North America. And those are the two competitors for this contract. This will be a 10-year contract. It will cover development activities, continued development activities, and our deployment activities for the National Missile Defense Program. So, and of course, the centerpiece of all this activity was the successful integrated flight test 1A that I just talked about. Very important to the program, very visible, and of course we think is the cornerstone of the program. And with that, I'd like to stop my formal remarks and overview and entertain any questions that you have on the program in general, and specifically on the flight test. I have Mr. Don Boster, who is the program manager for the ground-based interceptor, and he is from Huntsville, Alabama. As a member of the Federated Joint Program Office in Huntsville, Alabama, he can answer any specific technical questions we may have. And Cecil Webster, Colonel Cecil Webster, who is in charge of test and evaluation at the Joint Program Office level. So, sir, can I ask?
I'm sorry, you said Boeing, and what was the other company?
United Missile Defense Corporation. It is a joint venture. The primary folks are Lockheed Martin that are part of that joint venture, TRW, and Raytheon. Those are the primary players in that joint venture. There are several other companies that support that, sir.
How much is that 10-year contract expected to be?
I really...
Probably an initial one-year contract.
Yes, sir. Yeah. What we will provide for them is a base period contract, a 3-year contract initially. And I really don't have the dollar value of that contract yet. We've provided them what we believe is a band of dollars that will be available for them for that 3-year period.
And what is that? You mean a range?
A range, yes, sir.
What is that?
I'll have to get that number for you, and I'll be glad to do that afterwards.
How does the QDR money added in the QDR affect your plans? What's changed?
Yeah, the question is, we received additional permission to at least compete for additional funding as a part of the quadrennial defense review process. And the Secretary approved $2.1 billion additional RDT&E money for the program over to FYDP. What that has done is allowed for me to add the additional rigor of testing to the program that did not exist, frankly, and to really put some meat on the bones of the program, because the program as it was funded previously was a technology readiness program, and the funding profile essentially didn't change when we made it a major defense acquisition program in the spring of 1996, and it had to change because there are completely different activities involved in a technology readiness program and then a formal major defense acquisition program. So there's a lot of test, There's a lot of test activities that I've been able to make more vigorous with that additional money, and other activities that support the program. But testing is a primary feature that we have in the program.
What happens if the Hughes test is successful in January? Then when do you have a down select on that?
We have a down select in 1998, and we'll have a down select after each competitor flies one intercept test. That's the current program that's outlined. Now, as a part of the lead system integrator proposal that we are getting from the two competitors, we've asked them for their thoughts on how to do this exo-atmospheric kill vehicle down select. They may have some different ideas, but right now the government's plan is to conduct two sensor flybys, one each competitor, and one each intercept, and then down select. But we'll wait for the proposals to come in and see what the prime contractor or the lead system integrator proposes before we complete that process. Yeah, John.
This is a follow-up on Garrett's question. Sure. You said the testing's more vigorous and you're putting more meat on the bones, but Right. Where's the beef? The $2.1 billion, specific ways is this testing more vigorous as a result of that money or the prospect of that money? And does that include any additional tests between now and a potential presidential decision in 2000?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Can you throw the one up that shows the test up to 1999? It's about 4 or 5 and deep. The sad fact of the matter is that it takes a long time, long lead time for some of the items that we need for this program, like to build a set of targets. Takes from 12 to 15 months to build a set of targets. Sandia National Labs actually builds the targets for us. For the contractor to build the exo-atmospheric kill vehicles that we need, takes about 24 to 30 months right now. And so you can see that the tests that lead up to about 1998, I can't influence those tests that much, but I can influence the 1999 test because it's almost 1998 now. So a lot of the dollars that we will get in 1998, I will procure those items that you'll see that will show up in 1999 and beyond. And if you remember on this particular chart, here we're going to have a complete backup set of targets and interceptor available in case something goes wrong with this very important integrated system test number 5 in 1999, because this is really kind of the capstone of these two sensor, two intercept, but this integrated system test is an attempt to put together all pieces of this particular puzzle, and it leads to the decision in the year 2000. And all this activity, I've added additional tests here and all these other additional tests, are costed as a part of that program plus up that makes up that $2.1 billion that we were given in the QDR. Now, just because the Secretary of Defense allowed me to compete for $2.1 additional billion dollars, I underline compete because we are competing for that $2.1 billion. And so far in 1998, the plus up that we requested was $474 million, and the Department approved that to go forward to Congress. And so far, all the committees have been very favorable for the program. But I want to emphasize that every year thereafter, I still have to compete for those dollars. Those dollars are not just there, but those dollars are there just programmatically for me to plan for. But you can see by looking at that chart that we just took off that that's okay, Rick. That the program, the test program, is, I think, vigorous enough so that I, as a program manager, will have the confidence and the results and the data to go forward to the decision makers in the year 2000 and beyond and say, yes, I think we've got the kind of program that would do the mission that you want to do.
In 99, the answer is the $2 billion, if you survive the budget process, will be used to for those backup tests if necessary, starting in 99.
That's just part of it, John, and there's a lot of it that you don't see, like the integrated system test capability at Huntsville, this hardware-in-the-loop simulations facility that supports the overall test activity. A lot of the additional dollars will be added to that test facility also, and other test activities that support the very visible flight test. But there's a lot of dollars that are in there, in the base, if you will, that support the program activities. But as I said early on in this program, that we were test poor in this program, and that I would do everything possible to make sure that we did have a vigorous and viable test program, and so we're trying to follow through with that.
Yes, General, ma'am. You said that the system, as you're developing it, has to be treaty compliant.
Yes.
But to deploy, it depends on the threat whether or not it has to be treaty compliant.
That's correct.
So you're talking about the ABM treaty there.
We're talking about the ABM treaty primarily.
What is the difficulty as you design the system having to deal with compliance issues, or is there any?
It's really not. If you'll show the plug and defend chart, I think we've got a great approach to this that allows me to go do all the development activities that are necessary to keep a very flexible architecture. And as I said earlier, this system will be deployed essentially based upon how this United States government sees the threat against the country. And so the threat could change, obviously, and the requirements that I have could change based upon the threat. But I've put together a very flexible a number of architectures based upon an element toolbox. And so I'm developing the radars, the interceptors, the battle management command and control that put all this together, and the early warning devices that make this a complete system. Now, based upon how the threat matures, then we will deploy a specific architecture for that threat. And that I think that gives us the kind of flexibility that we need in this 3+3 program. So we can be treaty compliant as we go through and develop these elements, if you will, and our testing can be treaty compliant. But if our government sees that the threat to the United States requires something that may change, that we may be required to make changes to the treaty or deploy in a non-compliant manner, we will be able to do that if necessary. Yes, sir.
I might have missed something here, but it sounds like the system is almost all a reactive system in that you react after the missile is launched. Did I overlook something?
No, sir, that's exactly correct. It is a defensive capability. We use space-based means, if you will. Let me see if I have a chart here just to clarify that for you. Yeah, you'll just pull it out. We use space-based early warning devices to detect that there has been a launch. And we currently do this now. Obviously, we have those capabilities now. And then based upon some algorithms, we determine where that possible impact point will be. So we get the initial detection here. Later on, with the SBIRS, space-based infrared system low, that could become a part of the architecture in the future, we'll be able to track that cold body as it goes in outer space. And then later we pick it up with ground-based radars and have, if you will, a better fix on where the target vehicle is and where the decoys and replicas are, and then we launch against it. So you're exactly correct. It is a defensive capability only.
But, I mean, although it's defensive, it sounds like there might be an element to the system that detects a threat area, or I mean, I would assume that a missile of that type would be substantial and would require a substantial support, ground support.
Sir, we intend to only have a very few number of sites. As I said, to be treaty compliant, we would probably only have one site. If we decided to be non-treaty compliant, there could be other sites as far as the missile sites itself. But the primary detector are your early warning surveillance devices and where they look. And those are very important to the system because those are the initial eyes of the system. And then later on, you will have coverage by the early warning radars. But these are the first things that see the threat launched.
Second question, are you considering at all the UAVs?
No, sir.
As part of this system?
No, sir. This is strictly defense against strategic ballistic missiles, intercontinental ballistic missiles, if you will.
Thanks.
That's the primary person. And we're not, we don't have a mission against UAVs or cruise missiles for this particular system. And the initial system is a land-based system.
I don't want to harp on this, but
go ahead.
You're more than doubling your
QDR
proposes more than double your budget.
Sure.
So to make sure I understand this, the one thing you'd use it for is these optional tests, these options you've added in there?
We actually added more than just optional tests. The original program plan only called for one test per year beginning in the year 2000. Now, we're going to fund an additional test, and obviously I have to fund all those long lead items for those optional tests. So I'm spending that money. Remember, it takes a couple of years to build an exo-atmospheric kill vehicle, and it takes a year or so to build the targets. So I'm committing in 1998 and 1999 a lot of long lead dollars for the program. And obviously, if we don't get a deployment decision, then we maintain a rolling capability to be able to deploy in 3 years. If a decision is not made in 2000, then in 2001, I still must be able to deploy in three more years. So those test articles will be used in the test program as we go down this path.
What does each test roughly cost?
The test itself is about $50 million is generally the price tag. Those are the targets, the kill vehicle, and so forth. But as I alluded to earlier, it's a lot more money that lead up to that test, all the testing with software in the loop and hardware in the loop. Yes.
Just to make sure I'm clear, clarification, you mentioned that obviously a decision could be made.
That's correct.
Or a deployment decision that would not be treaty compliant or ABM compliant. I assume you mean that the U.S. would then want to renegotiate the treaty. Mm-hmm. You wouldn't just bag the ABM treaty.
I'm not a treaty expert, and I would tell you those are the options that would be available to the policymakers. They renegotiate the treaty in a manner to satisfy whatever the deployment activity of the United States.
How are you going to integrate, or are you integrating all of this with theater missile defense and your atmospheric defense?
This is, again, just for defense for the United States of America, just national missile defense. But you can see, if you're familiar with the theater programs, that a lot of the early warning, space-based early warning devices are common to both theater as well as national assets. But this is just a national missile defense system for the United States. Yes?
You mentioned that there's been some activity in the BMC cubed area. Can
right.
you highlight what's been going on there?
Yes, I can. As we BMC cubed is one of the, is a tougher area because BMC cubed pulls it all together, and actually allows you to pull this all together to a command and control facility at Cheyenne Mountain. U.S. Sync Space is our user. In our program plan, we have 7 increments of battle management command and control that we're building, and the first increment, which is a very simplistic increment, we tested as a part of IFTY-1A. And essentially, the 7 increments go through a sequential progressive process of providing more information to the battle management command and control. And by the time we finish the 7th increment and deploy the system, obviously it'll be a full-up system. But each increment has a little bit different characteristic. But the initial increment provided the rudimentary command and control that we needed. That is, it said that there's a threat launch, we detect that threat launch, provide that information down to a command and control facility, and we were able to launch a vehicle and provide that launch vehicle a target in space to fly to. So that's a rudimentary part of Battle Management Command and Control that we just completed.
It was tested in the
It was tested in FD-1A. And we'll continue to improve that, yeah.
It performed
nominally. It performed well.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'd like to get back to the revised test schedule.
Yes.
With the additional competition for funding, you're basically doubling the IST test. Is actually doing those tests contingent on whether or not you have a decision to proceed in 2000 to deployment, or you'll do those tests either way?
Could I have that chart again, Rick, just to clarify? This is pretty tricky. At the top of the chart, the two tests per year will be done regardless. As I said, I upped this from one test per year to two tests. They will be done regardless of if we have a deployment decision or not. I'm buying all this material, hedging that we will get a deployment decision. I have to do that because of long lead items. And I'm buying that material in 98 and 99, so if we get a deployment decision, I'll be prepared to do these tests. Obviously, if we don't, then this material that I bought here, I'll use in one of these tests or use somewhere down the line in the test program. But that's a fair question. Yes, sir, in the back.
You talked about the ground-based radar being a prototype.
Right.
What made it a prototype? Was the antenna perhaps not fully populated or what?
It is not fully populated. We're still in the design phase of exactly the size of radar that we might use for the actual objective system. But it is a prototype because it does replicate, in at least concept, the ground-based radar that we could have as a part of the objective system. But I would suspect that the actual radar that we would deploy would be somewhat different than this one. It probably would be a little bit larger, but the concept would be principally the same, sir. And so we're obviously put it at Mech Island so we can use it as part of the test program as we continue the NMD program. Yeah, John.
This question might require you to put up the target scene chart, if you would. If you would you just walk through those nine targets, objects, and just say why you picked them and, to the unclassified extent you can, how they correspond to actual or projected threats?
Yeah. John's asked a question that in totality would be a classified answer, but let me just give you the answer that I can give, that all of these replicas and our decoys, balloons and so forth, are characteristic of those that might exist, that would exist, on threats that could be launched against the United States. Those are replicas or decoys that could appear on vehicles that could be launched against the United States. And that's the primary reason why we put together this target complex. And I'm sorry I can't give you the specific ones. Those are classified.
Are all those chaff or decoys, or some of them, say, weapons of mass destruction, submunitions, or, I mean?
John, just starting from there's really only one real reentry vehicle, and that's a medium reentry vehicle right here. The other ones do not have any kind of warhead on them at all. They're intended essentially just to decoy away your interceptor from the actual reentry vehicle. And so when we put together a target complex like that, we put it together based upon what we see as the threat that might materialize against the United States. So that's the purpose of these balloons and replicas, are to confuse the sensor or the radar on the ground so that when you send up this kill vehicle, you hit one of these replicas or you hit a balloon and you miss the RV and the RV comes in. And obviously that's what's so tough about this problem of hit to kill and this environment in which you have decoys or replicas, is that you've got to pick out the real one or you've wasted a shot.
Are you going to use the same target set in the intercept test as well?
Currently we are. This appears to be a good target complex. As I mentioned to John, it kind of replicates, if you will, a number of systems that we could face. As I said, I don't know exactly what the threat is, so when I look out there in the world, I have to cover essentially the lower end of the spectrum and relatively the high end of the spectrum, and so I'm kind of in the middle there. And I think it's a good complex for us. Did that answer your question, John?
Yeah, but a quick follow-up. follow-up, and this is an obvious one, but I feel it needs to be asked. Not only did it discriminate the wheat from the chaff,
right,
but it did it in the time period that it was supposed to?
In the time frame that it was supposed to. And everything was nominal in the time frame that could support an intercept if we had to. And we followed this up at the Joint National Test Facility with the rest of the problem, simulation-wise. We took this information from that sensor, fed into a simulation down on the ground at the Joint National Test Facility, and then actually conducted the intercept simulation-wise. I'll just say simulation until I actually have a metal-on-metal intercept. I'll be real happy. Yes, sir.
So how would you characterize the performance of the sensor?
I think the sensor was nominal. It performed as required. Yes, ma'am.
One more ABM treaty compliance question.
Right.
As you're designing the system through development, is there any technical differences on the systems that have to be made, or is it just a matter of when you deploy, how much do you deploy, and what do you deploy? Are there any real?
There are no limitations so far in the test program that I think would be limitations for me. There are no ABM limitations for me as I build the architectures that are needed.
It's not a design issue.
There are no design issues for me now for a land-based system. Now, if you talk about other systems, and there obviously we can't test other systems because of the ABM treaty.
Space.
But we're not intending to. This is a land-based system. In the back.
What's the next step for the ground-based radar as far as developing it to set up for the program?
I'm sorry, I missed it.
What's the next step for the ground-based radar?
The next step is that we will populate that mechanical array that I showed you with all the transmit-receive modules and all the electronics that supports it. And then we'll begin the integration activities next spring. And then we'll actually do an actual formal test of this radar as a part of the integrated flight test number 4. It will shadow that test in 1998. In other words, it won't be the primary radar. We'll still be using range radars, but we'll shadow it. And then it will be full up, a part of the integrated system test in 1999 as we try to put all the elements together that we've been developing. Another question.
Warren, you said you had an anomaly with the medium balloons.
Yeah, the closely spaced objects. Could you turn that back on? And I don't think I can tell you how close these were supposed to be, but as these two balloons were deployed, they were supposed to be very close together and would challenge the sensor to discriminate two balloons that were very close together. And this was a problem with the targets. Those two balloons did not come out in a fashion that they were close together, according to my engineers. So we were able to tell the two balloons apart, but they didn't meet the technical criteria being very close together. So that was not a primary objective of the test. It was one of those secondary objectives. But that was the only anomaly in the whole test program.
Yeah, back on the ground-based radar, for the fifth test, will the other range radars at Kwajalein also be used?
They'll be used in their normal data collection modes.
Or but they the will handoff not, will be from the ground
base? It will be from the ground base radar.
Does that cause you any...
not at all. I'm not anxious about it at all. I'm just ready to get it on. I'm ready to move forward with the program. But it doesn't cause... I think we have a lot of confidence in that radar based upon it was built on the THAAD demonstration validation radar. And so we have a lot of confidence in...
Doing any risk reduction tests as far as handoff from that radar
absolutely.
To the rest of the system?
What we'll do, if you recall the chart, throw the test chart back up with all the tests. We had these risk reduction flights, these Minuteman III flights. Now, as I bring that radar up online later on in 1998, I'll be able to use it to track these Minuteman flights that will be available for me to track. There are actually three of them per year in most years. I don't know why we show two there. Normally, there's about three. And these are normal, just operational flight tests of the Minuteman to test lot samples.